everyone. Welcome. We are the XoneBros. This is your positive gaming and Xbox One community.
Oh, man. We are so cool.
We are really cool.
Do you know why? Because we didn't screw up. Although there was a lot against us at that intro.
There was. I wasn't quite 100% ready for that.
You guys, so they were having a conversation over there. I kind of run the buttons on the show, and they were just having a conversation. I'm like, shut up, guys. It's going.
And yeah. We made it. Yeah. We made it. As always, well, first of all, welcome all you new listeners out there in Radio Land. We are glad to have you. Also, all you new Xbox One owners, hope you are enjoying it. Hope you're enjoying the community. Hope you're enjoying the clubs. Hope you're enjoying the games, most importantly. As always, I am joined by the bros, the X1Bros. First and foremost, it's Mr. McSpicy, Mark Haywood.
Woo! Hey, David.
How's it going, man?
It's going good.
Tell me, favorite gaming experience this week?
Gaming experience?
Yes. Gaming-related experience.
Well, I got to play Overwatch again. Ooh, it's kind of nice. Back in my... You know, your cycle.
It's in your repertoire.
Yeah, the gaming cycle. Now that I'm kind of Stardew Valley fleshed out of my system, I can now kind of go, oh, okay, what else can I do? So
very nice.
And I was able to finish my placement matches. I'm way behind that I should. But I felt like at the end of that, my soldier's on point now. So I feel like I can... You know, continue playing that game again. So.
Very nice. Well, I'm happy for you.
Yeah, me too.
I know how much you love that game.
It's a good game. It really is. So I'm excited. I'm excited again with games like that. The twitchy games, the shooters. If you back off a little bit, you kind of
you lose
that edge.
You lose your edge. Yeah.
But yeah. I feel like I'm doing pretty good. So good. I think what I've been doing. Sorry to keep going.
That's right.
I've been playing on quick matches a lot of. The cowboy. What's his name again?
McCree.
Thank you. McCree. And I think McCree on a console is incredibly difficult because of the controllers. Mm. But if you play McCree, it makes your soldier better.
Yeah, because you have to be more precise with him.
I think playing McCree has made my soldier better.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's good.
Yeah. So, very anyways, nice. Yeah.
Next, it's Jordan the Man, Jordan Paskett. Jordan, what is your favorite gaming-related event that happened this week or memory or experience?
I don't know.
You don't know?
I don't know.
He's just got so many.
Yeah.
Okay.
He lives the dream.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, well, just name one thing that you did.
That's what we're reverting to.
Oh, okay. I played that new game, Astroneer.
Oh, that's right.
Which was really fun.
That is fun. All right. Expanding your horizons.
Yes.
Literally.
Yeah.
Planet, one planet at a time.
You lost my rover.
Did you really?
Yeah, I jumped in. Jordan worked really hard for his rover. Well, because it's in preview mode, right? So it's yeah. kind of glitchy still, especially in multiplayer. So I jump in. I'm like, Jordan, let me. And I just drive his rover. And I'm driving. And the rover, I kid you not, me in the seat, the rover disappears. And I just start running. And it's gone. It's gone for forever.
That's funny.
And we don't know what happened to it.
That's way funny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I did travel all the way around the planet, though.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So Astroneer's cool. Like that Minecraft, No Man's Sky.
Stardew Valley
yeah. game.
Yeah.
When you say Stardew Valley, you're saying a whole bunch of a hybrid of other games, too.
Yeah. It's a lot of games rolled into one.
And you can be astronauts.
You can. That's the...
Different colored astronauts.
That's the big...
That'd be blue, red, yellow.
That's great.
That's the big appeal. Yeah. The big appeal.
It's just like the Nintendo Switch controllers. You can be neon.
Yeah, which I have those ones. That's the one I pre-ordered. I said, you know what? That's neat.
You got it. I like it. Nice. So,
you know what, guys? That is neato. Last but not least, I am X1. We are the X1 Bros. My favorite gaming experience was probably the Zelda announcement game. That game really... That really does it for me in more ways than one.
Can you imagine if like that game came to the Xbox?
Oh, it'd be so cool.
Yeah, it's not. But I mean,
if Nintendo ever went bankrupt and was selling off its assets, do you know the bidding war for their titles?
I bet you they would go to Sony just because the homeland.
Yeah,
homeland.
They're very like patriotic that way.
If I was Microsoft, I'd be hiring Japanese people right now.
Yeah,
in case
just
that
to
happens.
Get in there.
Think about the Japanese market.
They probably have. If you think about it, I mean, think of just Mario. I mean, when you think of gaming, like you can just put him up on a poster and he represents gaming. Right?
Oh yeah.
You know, I mean, just
he's the epitome of gaming.
They really have like the characters. You know.
Well, they would go the way of Sega, really. I found it ironic that Sega
was
on stage last night.
Yeah.
That was That was good.
And a sweet suit. That guy was wearing a sweet suit.
I told David, I said, that guy knows. Looks like he knows how to make video
games. And I said, that guy looks like he stepped out of Sleeping Dogs.
Yeah,
he did. Right out of Sleeping Dogs.
My favorite was the Splatoon guy, just because he was a little intense.
Oh, like, he was.
He was like, Splatoon!
My ears. Oh, man.
And then he like did his pose with his gun.
Yeah. Well, and I couldn't tell if he was a good actor or not.
Yeah.
Because it was in Japanese, and I was like, I don't know if he's a great actor, but I can't tell.
I was telling David, say what you will about Nintendo, you may like them or hate them, but they enjoy what they do.
Yeah.
And that was,
you know, they have no shame.
Yeah.
And you got to appreciate that.
Yeah. I was laughing probably 80% through that. Like, just I was just laughing my head off through that whole presentation. It was hilarious.
It was enjoyable. It was very enjoyable.
Like, it was fun.
It was like a board meeting where people are coming dressed as clowns and stuff. That's what it felt like. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
The guy that jumps in, the wrestler guy.
So see, I want to get that game, though. Like that.
For those of you that don't know what we're talking about, or if you lived under a rock for the last 24 hours, Nintendo had a press conference last night in which they announced and showed off their new console, the Nintendo Switch. And so that's what we're discussing. Yeah. So we got off track. Anyways, getting back on track, there's poker night tonight after the show. Everybody is welcome. If you miss it this week, it goes up on LFG in Xbox blah blah
clubs.
In Xbox clubs on Xbox Live.
Yeah.
Say that 10 times fast. Whoa.
Xbox clubs on Xbox Live. I can't do that fast. No. I did that slow, not very good.
Yeah, it's hard. So if you miss it this month, it will be there next month. Come and join us. We have a community play next week. It is Grand Theft Auto Stunt Racing.
That's going to be fun. I'm in.
Oh, yeah. Right.
I am in.
You are in. And that LFG, so Jord fun. The Man, will put up an LFG over at Xbox Club on Xbox Live. Yeah. The X1Bros Club on Xbox Live this week. So come and join us. It is at noon Eastern on Saturday. And that, again, if you miss that one, you can't make it. We have community plays every month. We pick a different game and play with the community. If you haven't yet, go check out our new blogs. We have an excellent and awesome creative team who is pumping out and writing amazing content that tickles the mind and warms the soul. So go check that out today. And also, please, go help us grow the site, the community, by donating to us on Patreon. Go check us out, x1bros.com/support. Or just go to Patreon and search X1Bros and help us grow. If you want to have an idea of what we're going for, what we're shooting in this product, in the X1Bros community, go check out our blogs and you can see perfectly, I think it illustrates perfectly, the type of website and community that we're shooting for. Mm. And with that, let's get this show on the road. Jordan, what is happening in the world that is Xbox One this week?
A lot.
Well, good.
Surprisingly,
actually,
it's kind of a slow news time of year.
The same amount as every week.
Okay. So it's an average week.
Yeah, yeah. Pit People is now available in game previews. So there's another game preview game for us, but it's available.
I know a lot of people are excited about Pit People.
Pit People. Yeah. So. Go check it out. Subterranean, now available for digital pre-order and download on the Xbox One. And then Rise and Shine is now available for Xbox One. That's a
really cool
platformer, yeah.
Really cool artwork there. Like
So that one's available for Xbox One.
Silvio.
And Dead Effect, these were both pre-order last week, but they're both now available. So Silvio and Dead Effect 2, now available for Xbox One. And Friday Night Bullet Arena. Now available for Xbox One.
I don't know what it is, but a pixelated dragon or Loch Ness monster always is a good thing.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen.
Acorn Assault, Rodent Revolution, now available for Xbox One. Then we have Nevermind, now available for Xbox One. And Mass Effect Andromeda, now available for pre-order.
Yes.
So you can get your digital pre-orders in on Xbox One.
Okay, guys, how far out do I need to start playing Mass Effect 3 in order to prepare myself for Mass Effect Andromeda? Should I start now? Should I have already been started?
It's March, so you don't have that much time. March
I
is
think
just
you'd
right
be
around
fine.
The corner.
Should I wait till February? Give it a month?
What are you going to be playing instead of that?
Horizon, 3. Stardew Valley,
Well, and then you got to remember... you got to remember that you're getting your new Nintendo in March, which is going to take up all those.
True. So I've got to
Games that are itching your soul right now, get them out of your system, and then start Mass Effect, and you should be good. Because Mass Effect will suck you into the universe. It's really good.
Okay.
It's one of those just story-driven games, and your choices, and you this is a game you would like.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So
I'm there. I will start this week.
Okay. Just get rid of the ones that are like there, and then just so you have nothing else to go to. Do that, and you'll burn it up in no time.
Yep. Doing it. Boom.
Very nice. So yeah, if you want that, go ahead and pre-order it right now. Knee Deep is now available for digital pre-order and download on the Xbox One, along with Hunter's Legacy.
Oh,
which you can pre-order and download on the Xbox One as well. And then we have Toby, Secret of the Mine, also available for digital download and pre-order on the Xbox One. And then we got some deals this week. And this, I think there's one game on here that is an excellent deal. So we got Saints Row.
That I'm going to get? Is that what you're saying?
No, we already have it.
Oh, okay.
Saints Row is on sale.
Yes.
Just so everybody knows, Saints Row.
Yes.
Re-elected. Saints Row re-elected. 75% off. We have Rock Band 4 Rivals Bundle, which is 30% off.
Yes.
And then I think the best game, in my opinion, I mean, they're all good games, but the best game here, Earthlock, Festival of Magic, 33% off.
Boom.
Which I think is a fantastic deal. It was free when it first came out, so if you're new to the Xbox, this puts it at $20.09.
Not bad.
Which is not bad.
And it's well worth it. If you don't get it, you're dumb. That's what Jordan's saying.
Yeah.
Just kidding.
It's no. It's a good game.
Yes.
You play as a desert scavenger named Ammon.
Oh.
Well, and his friends. Well,
I like the
people
name
that
Ammon.
Become his friends. Yeah.
Ammon's one of my favorite names of all time.
Ah. Yes.
What is
Ammon?
Okay.
Yeah. And Mark, you grow your ammunition.
Ooh.
Via plants. So Stardew Valley is kind of helping you out with, you know, your...
Oh, I'm prepared.
Yeah, you're ready to go.
I'm totally ready.
There's actually this section in your home base that's literally just all farm.
And you farming?
Just, you grow your plants, and you have to water them a certain amount.
That's
you can't,
awesome.
If you water them too much, they'll die. If you water them too little, they'll die. You got to get that sweet spot.
Are you serious? I'm going to kill all my guns. All my ammo.
But, Earthlock is really fun. I played it this week.
Nice.
So, also other deals. We have Castles at 25% off, Binaries 50% off, Fortified at 50% off, Ginger Beyond the Crystal 25% off, and for those singers, Just Sing at 50% off.
Yes.
So very, very cool. Mantis Burn Racing also at 33% off.
Now I'm looking at the 360 deals there, and it's all the Tropicos. Tropico is on Xbox One, and did I purchase that? Did I purchase that, Jordan? I think I purchased that.
No, I think you were going to, but you never did.
Oh.
I mean, we can check, but I don't think we have it.
Okay. I hope I do. I would like to play that game.
Yeah, Tropico is a cool game.
Anything that lets me be a dictator is right up my alley.
Did we mention there was three versions of Andromeda coming out?
Oh.
No, not. Different, like the standard deluxe, super deluxe.
Yeah, and I don't know what the... I just saw in chat somebody mentioned that, so...
Yeah. Yeah, I didn't see
it. So, everyone, there's three kinds.
Yeah.
They're all digital, and you can
60,
get stuff.
60, 100, and probably 200.
Whatever you want. Google more for research.
Hardware, we got two new controllers. We have the red controller.
Yes.
And then we have the green and orange one. Now, this is actually surprising. I would think with the new design labs, you can basically make whatever controller you want. I didn't think Microsoft would release more controllers. And here's my question to you. Do you think this is a waste of money for them? Like,
No.
I mean, I guess I think
more options is always good. I think people are going to buy them because they look sweet.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I guess they're cheaper because I think these ones are only like
$60.
Let
me put it
this
way.
You know?
If I'm out and I'm looking for another controller to pick up, because I'm probably only ever going to have one Elite controller for myself, but then for others to play with, I'm not getting a standard black one.
Mm-hmm.
Not with all these options. I'm getting something sweet. Yeah. And I'm probably going to have...
Let's say
I get three. I'm probably going to have a different kind.
Yeah. Well, that's my question, though. Like, I can get this red one on Design Labs, but I can make it more...
Is Design Labs more money, though?
I think Design Labs is a little bit more money.
Then
so
there
I guess
you go.
This is still $64.99. So what, for $20 more?
Yeah, that's true.
But...
I don't know. I'm just
curious. I was surprised.
But see, this is for your friends. These are your friends' controllers. Your
that's
controller
right.
is
they
the
can't
design
touch my
controller.
Design line. Yeah. This is the guest controller. Like towels.
Yeah,
you
have exactly.
Or in your case, guest bathrooms.
And you never monogram the guest towels. Never.
Or guest
hey,
showers.
That's what I should get. His and hers controllers.
Oh,
that would be from the design lab
for Valentine's Day.
That would
see
be
how
cool.
that goes over.
Yeah. Nothing says I love you more
like something for yourself.
Anyway, no, they do look cool. There's the orange and green one. And when I say orange and green, it's mostly green. It has orange under joysticks.
Yeah, I like that.
It actually it's underneath the joystick.
It's flare.
Yeah.
It's accent color.
So yes. The full joystick isn't orange. The under joystick
nuance.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and then the other one is just straight red. It has
under
a different
the skirt.
Red, under the skirt, yeah. The second one is just straight red. It has a different red tint on the back. But, I mean, they're cool. I was just thinking, I didn't expect them to do this because of, you know, they have design labs now,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You know, but anyway.
I did look up the Andromeda stuff.
Oh, yes. Yeah, so
go ahead.
How much does it cost?
It's 100. I don't know how the other one. I just looked up the most expensive one.
180?
No, it's 100 edition? Bucks.
Oh, 100
bucks. 99
oh, okay.
bucks.
Oh, okay.
And it's basically just you have early access to some co-op by a day, but it's basically just booster packs.
Okay.
Mm, yeah.
And well, you get armor sets and stuff like that. But,
yeah, like your typical.
You know,
yeah.
If you're into that kind of stuff, that's cool.
I remember
want a statue.
When I pre-ordered.
It's hard with digital, though, because this is for the digital deluxe edition.
Oh.
I remember when I pre-ordered, what was it, Dragon Age 2 or Mass Effect 2? One of them. I never pre-ordered Mass Effect 2, but I know when you pre-ordered like 2 or 3, one of them, you get the Dragon Age armor, which looked pretty cool.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Is it any armor like that?
Can I talk?
I don't know.
Can I talk about our next news story? Is it okay?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, our next news story is that it was Jordan's birthday this week.
Oh.
Yes.
Beam. Yes.
Yes. It was Jordan's birthday. So happy birthday, Jordan. We got you something. Mr.
Oh, you want me to grab it?
Yeah, Jordan, you should close your eyes.
Oh, okay.
Close your eyes. Chat. Chat, you're going to get to see this, and it will blow your mind.
Is it a Nintendo Switch?
It that would be hilarious. Yeah. Okay, and we'll place it right in front of his laptop.
Okay.
I can't. There's no room.
Right here on this side.
Is it another laptop?
No. Are your eyes closed, Jordan?
Yeah, I can't.
Are your eyes closed?
I can't see. They're closed, and my hands are over them.
Check it out, everybody. That is Jordan's birthday gift.
Oh, cool. Thanks, guys. I haven't even seen it yet.
Okay. And go ahead, Jordan. Surprise.
Oh, man. Yeah. How did you guys
there
get
you
that?
That's the Halo 5
I know what
statue.
That is. Yeah. That's like the bookcase thing.
Yeah.
Holy cow.
Happy birthday, friend.
Oh, thanks, guys.
Yeah.
We found one.
Where? That's impressive.
An old place called the internet.
Look at this thing.
Yes.
Yeah, super cool, right?
I'm going to take this half real quick.
Dude, isn't that cool? That is cool.
He's bigger than
when
my
hand. When it came, Mark was like, it's huge.
I had to custom build a box to hide it from you with tape.
Yeah. What reminded me, I totally forgot we would have went this whole show without presenting it to you, talking about pre-orders and statues. I was like, oh, hey, wait a minute.
Yeah, it's Jordan's birthday. Happy birthday, Jordan's man. Birthday.
Yeah. Anyways, happy birthday, Jordan.
Thanks, guys. That's really
We think Sarah's going to love it.
Oh, yeah, man. We can put our books in between it. That's what I've seen people use them for.
Yeah, yeah.
Like the bookshelf holders. Oh, thanks, guys. That's really cool.
Yep.
It'll go well with my warthog that I got for Christmas.
Yes, it will.
It was between this and a bidet.
Yeah. Well, yeah, actually, there was a really serious conversation about purchasing
No, I do
a
want
bidet.
A bidet. That's one of my life goals, to get a bidet.
I know. So that'll be next year.
That's next year's gift. Yeah. Moving on. Next
thanks,
story
guys. That's
in
really
the
news. Cool.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
I know. Now Jordan's going to be distracted.
Yeah, okay.
Master Chief's going to be staring at him.
Yeah. thanks, guys.
Next story is a big one.
Yeah. Beam.
And it's integration.
Yeah. Mike Ybarra, he's the head of the platform engineering team on Xbox, gave us an update basically kind of on all of 2007, but Beam, basically. It's coming.
It is coming.
It's coming, yeah. And it's going to be cool.
So, yeah. And we kind of have an announcement, semi-announcement on our side. We will be slowly, not necessarily moving away from Twitch, but focusing more of our efforts into Beam. It's just when we're looking at the community and we're looking at its integration into Windows 10 and into the Xbox, this is probably a better match for what we're doing with this show than Twitch is.
Mm-hmm.
So stay tuned. In a couple of weeks, we will be over on Beam streaming there,
yes.
Playing games there, the whole shot.
So I'm not going to go through the whole list. If you want, you can go to Major Nelson's blog or you can go to Xbox Wire. And he went out with a whole article just on what years. Basically, the bullet points are they're going to increase performance in gaming,
yeah.
Which is always good. You know, better ways to find, stay in touch, and share with your gaming friends.
Yes.
And
tournaments and arenas are getting updates.
Tournaments and arenas are getting updates. The coolest one, and the one I'm most excited for, is you can the Beam app, right? You instantly stream Beam on Windows 10 and Xbox One. The reason I'm so excited over this is because Microsoft owns Beam.
Yeah.
So they can basically do whatever they want, right? Whereas I think with Twitch, they can make a Twitch app, but they can only...
You're at the mercy of
Twitch. They don't own Twitch. And the Twitch app, it's not bad, but let's be honest, it's not good. You know, it's not the best.
I would say it's just above bad. Yeah, like, you're extremely limited. And we've gotten a couple editions, you know, that have addressed a lot of problems.
Issues, yeah.
So at least it works-ish
yeah.
right now. So you could say that.
There's
you
still
can
some
stream.
Issues.
Yeah. You just have a lot of issues mm-hmm. with it.
Yeah. So that's why I'm excited for this, because since Microsoft owns it, I feel that they have a little bit more freedom with what they do. And since they own it and they're going to want to push it, I feel like it's going to get a lot more attention than the Twitch app.
I think it's healthy for the streaming yeah. community. I think YouTube gaming is healthy for it. I think Beam is going to be healthy. I think mm-hmm. having that competition, just like with gaming consoles, mm-hmm. makes the product better for the rest of us.
Yeah.
McSpicy, you had something to say earlier. I saw you raise your hand when we were talking about moving ourselves over to Beam. Did you have something that you wanted to add?
Or were you just raising your hand?
My attention span and memory is very, very slim. Okay. I don't know.
Okay. Well, there you go.
I remember. We're going to still be streaming on Twitch for those that like to come and join us as well. So yes. We're just going to be dual streaming, and we will just be pushing, you said it, really.
Yes.
We'll just be pushing Beam a lot more. But mm-hmm. don't worry, Twitch streaming is still going to be around.
Yes.
For the live show.
And if you haven't checked out Beam, go check it out. It's free. It's just like Twitch. So
might as well.
Yeah. You get to watch games. That's all it is.
You get to watch video games.
Yeah. So, but no, I'm excited for that, because I think them owning it, they have a little bit more freedom to do what they want. So I hope it's going to be good. I think it's going to be better than the initial Twitch app. So.
Yeah,
it's really exciting. Call of Duty fans, first of all, you have a double experience weekend this weekend, starting today, January 13th, going through the weekend.
Okay, yeah.
Double XP and a new gun game mode.
Oh,
so very cool.
That's always fun.
New game modes are always fun.
Like a new Christmas present.
Yep.
All right.
Anyway, moving on, Titanfall also has a new mode that gives teams only 1 minute to complete their objective.
Oh, I got to try this.
Yeah, it looks like a very cool mode. In live fire, you have 1 minute to take down all enemy pilots to win the round.
So are these...
It's just like a fast...
Are these AI enemy pilots?
I don't know. I'm assuming it's still the 8-on-8 or 4-on-4.
I would think it would be PvP. Yeah.
Okay, PvP. It's got to be an incredibly small map.
Alternatively, you can win if your team is able to hold a neutral flag when the timer runs out. So it's basically
it's forcing you
a minute to hold the flag, or you have a minute to kill.
It's forcing
but it's all
everybody
forcing
together.
Everybody the same.
That is so aggressive.
Yeah,
let's
do it. No, you're not holding back.
No, you
can't.
You're all in.
Also, two new maps are coming to Titanfall with the update called Stacks and Meadow. These maps, which are described as tight, enclosed death boxes.
Oh, I like that.
So if you're claustrophobic, these may not be the maps for you.
That's the ultimate description of a death box.
Yeah, they are only available in live fire, so this game mode has its own specific maps to address its own specific game mode.
Gotcha. Right? Yeah.
So very cool. Titanfall, I haven't played it as much as I wanted to, but every time I do play it, I have a ton of fun. I did get brutally murdered last time I played, and maybe that turned me off from it because it was just traumatic.
Yeah.
It's hard to suck at something.
No, it really is.
Oh, it hurts your feelings.
The video Sheever, Toast, and David both like all curb stomped me at the same time. Yeah. It was pretty bad.
No, that's awesome though.
So, in addition to the DLC, Respawn announced that it is working on a significant update to the multiplayer playlist interface. And then they show a picture of what the new preview looks like.
What do we think?
The picture really doesn't show me much. It looks just different is all. Like it's the same, but it's different, I guess.
It's just tweaked a little bit.
Yeah, just tweaked a little bit.
Streamlined.
More aesthetically pleasing, I guess, is kind of the best
I see
one
that.
For
it's
it.
A little more minimalistic.
Yeah, so, but, all updates for Titanfall, I believe, are free.
Okay.
So I didn't see them talk about a price with this, because I believe all updates to Titanfall are going to be free, which is great, you know. I appreciate it when I don't have to spend money.
Oh, amen. Yeah, that's great.
Who doesn't, right?
Yeah.
You know, why be mad at free stuff? But anyway, also with Titanfall is apparently there's a mobile game that I had no idea about, but it got canceled. So I guess there's no reason.
So the Titanfall mobile game has
it
been
was called,
canceled.
It was called Titanfall Frontline. It's a mobile game, obviously based on on Titanfall. But I guess it went into a beta, a closed beta, but it's being canceled before the launch. So
okay.
So if you were itching to play that, sorry, it's gone. Injustice has a new trailer. Well, not a new trailer, but a new trailer coming. They posted a small clip of what I'm assuming is going to be a part of this trailer. And it was basically Superman holding, I'm assuming, a woman.
Oh,
and she's
who's that?
Draped in like a white cloth over her head.
Lois?
I don't know. A lot of people think it's Supergirl.
Oh.
But it could be Lois.
Well, he doesn't
in the first Injustice, Lois was a significant part of the storyline.
Yeah.
So.
And he was pissed.
And he, Superman flipped.
Oh, he lost his mind.
If you haven't played Injustice, what you should do is honestly just go watch. You can probably just type Injustice movie is usually what they're called.
On YouTube,
And just watch all the cutscenes because the story itself, it's like watching, the cartoons. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's
so
good.
It's really good. With
and they
the
have
Joker
some good ones. I've watched some of them. They have someone did a good job.
Yeah, yeah,
I don't know
just
who it was.
Putting it all together. Yeah. So and there, I would watch that before Injustice 2 comes out, just because, Injustice 2 will probably continue off of that story. But go check it out. It's posted on Twitter on the Injustice site or the Injustice Twitter, whatever you want to call it, page. But very cool picture. So we're gonna get the teaser later next week.
Okay.
Or the new reveal later next week. Yeah. So which pretty cool. Pretty cool.
Pretty cool.
So moving on, Destiny gets some hot fixes this week. Some of the fixes are going to be some patrol missions in the Plague Land are not reliably causing enemies to drop their respective objective items, so they're going to fix that. Xur's curio inventory varies on a weekly basis due to a limitation of his inventory space. They're going to work on that. And then weapon stability on the Nova, Mortis, and abandoned exotic machine guns is inconsistent.
Nice.
So they're going to work on that. So those are hot fixes. I haven't played Destiny in a little while, so those names
are...
I mean, I recognize her.
I do too, yeah.
But I haven't played Destiny probably since the second week after Rise of Iron came out. But some hot fixes incoming, which is great. All right, this is for everybody. I've signed up, so I probably
won't
get it.
Where do I sign up? Why didn't you tell me to sign up for it?
All you do is click that little blue link right at the top. It'll say forhonor.ubisoft.com. But anyway, For Honor beta registration is now available. The beta is going to go. It's going to be a closed beta from January 26th through the 29th.
Oh, very nice.
What warrior faction would you fight for? I'm going to be samurai.
Who did you fight for?
I'm going
Jordan?
Samurai.
Yeah, I went samurai as well.
Screw you both. I'm a Viking.
Well, I was debating between Vikings and samurai.
Vikings are awesome.
Yeah, but samurai are awesome, too.
Not as cool as Vikings.
I don't know. I've seen some pretty cool samurais.
Vikings are... look at this. Look at that. Do you want to mess with those guys?
Okay, hold on.
Do you want to mess with those guys? I don't think so.
How did you get to that screen?
When you complete your registration.
Okay, I'm going to complete it right now.
When you complete your registration, it shows a picture of your faction. And the Viking faction, there's a giant dude in a helm with horns on it and an axe. And let me tell you.
For some reason, it showed you the knights.
Why does samurai look like knights?
Because for some reason, it showed you the knights. Those are not the samurai.
Because they don't want to...
Oh, I already registered for the beta. Oh, sweet.
They don't want to make you laugh at the weakness of the samurai people.
I don't know. Vikings are cool. I'm not taking away from how cool Vikings are.
You are. You insulted my...
No one cares about the knights.
Just the swords that they use and how they're like... They wear togas. That's cool.
That is true. Okay, that is cool.
So January 26th through the 29th is going to be the beta. If you don't get in, don't worry, because the game just comes out a few weeks after that in February on Valentine's Day, I believe. Valentine's Day the 14th.
Okay, samurai are cool. There's samurai right next to the Viking.
Yeah, see, look at that.
But notice they put the Viking in the middle.
And the
because he's like the big meat shield.
He's the leader.
Because he's the dumb one.
The knight looks freaking sweet, too, though.
Yeah,
in that picture.
Looks cool.
Oh, so, I'm so excited for that game.
Yeah, what you get is, obviously, you get a chance. It's a chance. It's not an open beta. It's a closed beta. So you're signing up, and you're going to be randomly picked and all that good stuff. I mean, there's probably a high chance that you'll be invited, but, it's still a chance. So there's a chance you'll be invited to the beta. There's a chance you'll win exclusive rewards and then gear updates, and you'll get all the gear updates and latest news from For Honor by signing up. But...
news on
Very
For
cool.
Honor, our winner last week of our Patreon drawing chose For Honor.
Yeah, that's a good pick. I'm excited for that game.
Who
isn't? That's going to be my Valentine's Day.
Who isn't? That's my Valentine's gift to my wife, For Honor.
Right, that's like Homer Simpson giving Marge a bowling ball that says Homer.
Yeah, right?
She's gonna love a.
I'm gonna get my
PvP. Tiffany's totally gonna love a PvP game.
Yeah.
That has Vikings and samurais killing each other. And it's totally her thing.
If you have it, there's been a lot of videos going up before Honor lately. Go check them out. It looks very cool. They haven't been showing the I call it the Dynasty Warriors mode. They haven't showed much of that. They've showed more of just the straight 1v1s to 4v4s. You know.
I've seen the Dynasty Roy whatever.
I've
seen it on Twitch.
I'm really excited for that mode. I think that's going to be my main mode, just because I enjoy Dynasty Warriors and I like the mixture of.
It's kind of like, you know what I mean? Dynasty Warriors meets a MOBA.
Yeah,
that's what that is. They're just waves of tons of people that you can mow down, and then you single out. It's like watching. It's just like watching a Michael Bay movie. You single out that one guy and you make eye contact, and then you just pass. It's like First Night. You ever see First Night?
Oh yeah, yeah.
Where they're fighting, and then the bad guy sees, you know,
from across the field, and like no one attacks them.
And no one. There's just fighting going on around, and they just walk towards each other, and occasionally stab a guy. That's exactly how that
they're so determined to get to the other guy to kill him.
Slice. They don't even change their icon. It's awesome.
That's funny. But yeah, it looks. I mean, especially if they have like ranked matches for the different team modes and stuff. I think that'll be really, really quite fun. The next beta is also another one that I'm excited for. This one you don't have to sign up for. You just have to be a member of Xbox Live, pretty much. The Halo Wars multiplayer beta for Blitz mode is going to be available January 20th. It's not the game. It's not full on multiplayer. It's just the Blitz mode beta. You're going to be, and this is their new mode.
This is open
with the
beta.
Cards. Yes, open beta. You don't have to sign up for it. It just on that day, download it, and you're good to go. You have 12 cards. How Blitz modes works is it basically takes out the building aspect. It's just straight combat strategy.
Yeah.
You have a deck of cards. You have, I think it's 12 cards. Yeah. These 12 cards have different units, abilities, stuff like that. You use those cards.
And that creates your
and
army.
And that creates your army. Yeah, you'll use certain cards at different times. Like if your army's. Maybe you drop in from behind with some ODST's cards, you know.
Yeah.
Cool stuff. They have a 1v1, a 2v2, and a 3v3 mode.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh,
so that'll be that'll be very exciting.
In their normal modes, have they talked about, do they have a 4v4
mode? I am sure in the, but see, I think in the, I don't know, 3 might be their number.
Okay.
But I would assume in maybe the normal modes where you do build stuff, they would have a 4v4. I'm trying to think if Halo Wars 1 had a 4v4.
I think it did. Pretty sure.
I can't remember if it did or not, but yeah.
I don't know, though.
Yeah. What do you do?
What do you do?
But anyway, so this is very exciting. So two betas around the same time. This is available January 20th, and I believe this one runs for a week.
Have you seen the new Blitz trailer, McSpicy?
No.
It came out this week. You should go watch it.
Mosey on over.
That is going to be your mode as well.
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
It is like if you take StarCraft and throw in Hearthstone and merge the two.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, because you're collecting cards, you're trying to get cards, you get packs of cards. I'm sure there's going to be really rare cards.
Mm-hmm. When you get the cards, do you keep them forever, or is it like a burn?
That's what I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. That's a great question.
And that would be interesting. Like, I could see it would be, I can see it being fun both ways. Like, you have a super rare card, but the fact that it burns when you use it, like, do you
makes
use it?
Me
you know
never
what I mean?
Want
to
use it.
Yeah, you know, but.
I would prefer to keep all my cards. I'm a hoarder. I'm a card hoarder.
But I don't know. It can go either way.
That's a really
good
question.
We will find out on January 20th. Yeah, it goes from the 20th to the 30th, so it's a week long, a little more than a week, 10 days, but very cool. Gears of War also had a update. Update 3, I believe. Title Update 3. But it comes with two new maps, which is great. Let me go to it. So it comes with two new maps, and I'll get to those in a minute, but the big part is they changed, you know how you have the card packs in Gears of War?
Yeah.
So they changed some of the pricing on those. So the Operations pack is now 800 credits, and the credits are in-game. They were formerly 1,000 credits, so they've gone down, so it makes it a little bit easier to get them in-game. They're still $199 if you want to buy it with just your cash.
Yeah.
The Elite packs are 2,000 credits, and those were formerly 350 or 3,500 credits, so that's a big bump down.
Oh, okay.
So a little bit easier to get them in-game. Still $4.99 if you want to buy the Elite Pack just with your real money. And those don't do anything to impede multiplayer, I guess. The like versus mode, they're strictly cosmetic stuff.
Sure.
Horde mode, stuff like that.
Okay.
So bounties, all that fun stuff.
I can appreciate that.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, if it's like Warzone, right?
Yeah.
You can buy the cards. It won't do anything in the arena, but, you know.
Yeah, okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I get it.
Yeah,
I get it.
Picking up what I'm putting down?
I'm picking it up.
So, and then you got two new maps, Clock Tower. which is an old favorite, and then Blood Drive, which is also an old favorite. So two revamp maps.
Cool.
Now, these are available in the developer's playlist if you're a season pass holder, but they should be coming to the regular playlist in a little bit.
Cool.
So you'll be able to play. Lego City Undercover, official trailer for the Xbox One. Ooh. So if you want if you want another Lego game, I believe this one is already out on older consoles.
I don't think so.
Or is this like because wasn't there a Lego City? Or is this like a sequel to the Lego City?
I think
City?
This is a sequel.
Ah. Fascinating.
Yeah, I never played the original, so I wouldn't know either.
Yeah.
So it's Lego City Undercover.
I watched the trailer as I posted it on Facebook this week, and it looks pretty good.
Yeah, it looks like a good, Lego game. Lego games are fun.
Yeah.
Right? You're a true. Cop. Yeah. You're an undercover cop.
And that's cool.
A good-looking undercover cop.
Look at that hair.
Yeah.
I mean, wow.
Chiseled face. So, anyway, that trailer is now out. If you want to check it out, it looks pretty fun. I mean, if you like Lego games, I'm sure you'll enjoy this.
Cool.
So, the last story is probably the biggest news story of the week. Scalebound.
Huge.
Has been canceled, and I find that funny because last week when I went over the games, the exclusives coming to Xbox One.
When
we got to Scalebound, I said this is the one I'm most excited for, and then they heard me and they decided to cancel it.
They have a special conference meeting. Jordan likes us. What do we do?
Well, let's just cancel it.
Okay, yeah, let's go golfing.
So explain to everyone why it was canceled. What happened? So, what came out of this?
The details are no one knows if Jim and Joe offended someone or whatever. But basically, what happened was, from what it sounds like, from what I've read on the internet, I mean, this isn't straight
planning
games.
Fact.
Yeah. Basically, the game wasn't progressing the way it should.
Sure.
It's been in development for 4 years. It has been missing its kind of deadlines, I guess.
Sure.
And Microsoft decided to cancel it because they were the publisher behind it. So that's really what happened.
Gotcha. Okay.
And then they talked about the other lineup. They basically said, hey, we're sorry, but this game, we've come to the decision that we're going to cancel this game. But they did talk about the rest of their lineup: Halo Wars 2, Crackdown 3, Sea of Thieves, all these other games they have lined up for this year. Try and
do it.
Yeah. Try and.
I don't know where to help you.
I don't know. But anyway, Platinum came out and they said, quote, "We are very disappointed things ended up this way, especially since we know many of our fans were looking forward to the game as much as we were. Going forward, we will strive to continue developing high-quality games to you, starting with Nier Automata, which is on the PlayStation right now, in March, including products like Grand Blue Fantasy, Project Relink, and Lost Order in the future. We will keep working hard to meet your expectations. Look forward to your continued..." Basically, your typical, hey, we're sorry that this happened, but we're looking to the future, right?
Yeah.
And that's kind of what Microsoft said, too. Hey, we're sorry this happened. These are the lineups we have for this year, So... the internet, I feel, was kind of split 50-50 when I was reading all the comments.
Sure.
I mean, there's your typical... We won't even get into those. But anyway...
Those people.
Yeah, there's those people, right? That were starting all these arguments. But I mean, some people were just like, hey, I wasn't really interested in this game. So, it doesn't do much for me, basically. And then there was other people, hey, this game looked really cool and different. So I think it was split 50-50. I personally was pretty excited for this game.
Well,
so I was sad to see it go.
This did make huge news. Out of all of the stories that we have ever posted on our Facebook page, this was by far the biggest. Mm-hmm. It had almost 100 comments. It had almost 100 shares. This was big news to a lot of people.
Yeah.
And I think because it was such a unique game.
Yeah, it was.
A lot of people were excited. A new concept, playing with dragons and riding in and flying them. It's disappointing that Platinum couldn't get their stuff together and get it figured out. So I will say there's been a lot of overreaction, I think, to this. A lot of people saying, oh, Xbox is downhill now. That's it. Their portfolio sucks. To that I say, calm down. Take a deep breath. And that's not correct.
You are lying.
Yeah. No, I just don't think... I really don't think it's a huge deal. It was... Microsoft made a business decision based on Platinum not being able to accurately represent what Microsoft perhaps felt.
That's just what we heard. And if you think about it from Microsoft's perspective... I'm not defending them in any way, but if you think about it, this game has been in development for 4 years, so they're putting money into it for 4 years. And from what it sounded like, deadlines were not being met. So at a certain point, money does become an issue.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it most definitely does. One comment on the IGN show that I saw and heard was that Not time to panic yet, guys, but this you should question the bigger picture. And I think that's completely false. And someone from Microsoft actually tweeted out or sent a message that a bunch of people retweeted that the culture of hate around Microsoft was already created. And he said when they look at their numbers, there is like four times as many stories about them canceling this game than there has ever been combined entire news about this about mm-hmm. Scalebound. And so he said it's just basically they made the point. It's just people piling on to Microsoft at this point.
How many times have I said it? If you go back to the earlier podcast, I think people hate Microsoft just to hate Microsoft. One thing that bothers me, and I've said it a million times, and this is actually the thing that, like, if anything bothers me in this world, it's this. When people, like, they're like, oh, that darn Microsoft, and they'll spell Microsoft, they'll put the S as a dollar sign.
Yeah.
And they're like, that darn Microsoft with the dollar sign S, all they're about is money. This is why I go Sony. And I'm like, you don't think they're in it for money? Like, it frustrates me.
Well, no, I do think that tweet was accurate, and just it's a completely irresponsible thing to say that you need to question the big picture, like what, like Xbox clubs, like Project Scorpio doing so well, like Play Anywhere. Can the PlayStation do Play Anywhere? Is it committed to doing Play Anywhere with all of its exclusives? Like the big picture, merging with Windows 10, getting gaming all around one ecosystem. Mm-hmm. The big picture for Xbox and Microsoft is fine. This does not change any of that.
And look at the lineup they still have. We have Halo Wars coming soon. We have Crackdown 3. You have Cuphead, which I know, Mark, you're really excited for.
Looks so good.
I mean, you still have a solid lineup of games this year. And that's just three of them. There's more.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, and I think that you get people in the bubble media on the coasts. That's where all the electronic media is, the gaming media, and they make a big deal out of something that is really ultimately not that big deal. We have Sea of Thieves coming out, which is
Sea of Thieves. Sorry, I forgot that one. Sea of Thieves, which is probably behind Scalebound, probably the one I was most excited for.
And then
as
we don't
well,
even know what we have at E3. And not to mention, name me PlayStation's big unique IP that is dropping in 2017. Can anyone name me it?
No.
Other than Horizon Zero Dawn, that's the only one.
It exists, but they announced it, and everyone always says, "Oh, PlayStation." And I love PlayStation. Don't get me wrong, but there's a double standard applied. Oh, PlayStation has so many more unique games exclusive games. Yeah, that they've announced that are coming out in 2019 and 2020.
Let's take the new Uncharted game that's coming out, the Lost Chapters or whatever. If PlayStation canceled that game, it would not be as big a deal as if Microsoft canceled. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It would not be.
Well,
I don't think.
I don't know if you could say that, but
no, I feel very confident.
Okay.
In that.
Okay. Okay.
So I agree. I think there's a double standard when it comes to Microsoft and Sony.
Yeah.
I think it's a shame because I think they're both good. They both do good things. I mean, they both do things that disappoint you. But
yeah, this may be coming across as we're huge Xbox fanboys. We are, but we're also fanboys of every other console. You know what I mean? We're gamers. We love that stuff. The thing about that comment, it's comments like that. So I try to keep my mouth shut a little bit with this because it kind of upsets me when comments like that are made. So I just got to bite my tongue because I'm getting in trouble.
The comment that, and this came from an IGN Xbox editor who shall not be named,
Google it.
Anyways, but he said, now's not the time to panic, but you should be concerned about the bigger picture. What bigger picture? Bigger picture is at stake here?
It's comments like that that drive me away from your mainstream media sites.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't watch reviews from anywhere except watching people play on Twitch or watching Let's Plays on YouTube. That's my reviews. I want to see people's reactions, real people playing that. Mm-hmm. So it's just, it frustrates me as a guy that just likes to play video games.
Well, it's just sensational.
Yeah. It's clickbait comments.
Yeah.
And that just drives me crazy. Yeah. I don't know. It just bugs me that that's the norm with mainstream media.
Not talking about the other games? I mean, you got State of Decay 2 coming out this year. You have Gigantic, which is now in preview program this year.
Gigantic,
you know?
Fabulous.
You have that Tacoma, another indie title that's coming out that looks really good. I mean, you have all these games that you still have a good lineup.
We are all very disappointed, and I think that's what made this news story. It shows you how many people were looking for a game like Scalebound.
Yeah.
I will say this, and I do agree with this, and this is why a big reason why I like the PlayStation. I do feel like Sony and even Nintendo in some respects have more JRPGs than Xbox, and I wish Xbox would get more games like, you know, like Final Fantasy 15, you know, or Scalebound. I like those
kinds Xenoblade
of games.
Or
Xenoblade. Xenoblade.
With the buttless chaps that that guy's wearing.
Yeah. Yes. See? With shorts underneath. Yeah. Jean shorts at that.
Yeah. But, I mean, it's hilarious. I mean, they're definitely funny. But Xenoblade is a fantastic game. It's a very Final Fantasy-esque game. It's fun, you know.
Metal Gear Solid,
yeah. That's came to the Xbox. So, but I do think Sony and Nintendo do have more JRPGs.
Yeah.
Which I personally really like. You know, so it would be nice to see more. That's what more another reason I was Xbox. So excited for Scalebound and stuff.
Not I mean, is it that, a big deal know, that game's not coming? Yes. It doesn't mean Microsoft's in trouble. No, it has nothing to do with Microsoft. It was Platinum. Platinum's in trouble. If you want to be concerned about anyone, you should be concerned about Platinum Games.
Yeah.
I mean, that's
taking 2 years and not having any fruits from it.
Yeah.
That's really what's happened, right?
Four years.
Yeah, 4 years and there's no fruit. So that's. That's kind of hard on a business.
It's kind of crappy.
Yeah. That's crappy. So.
Anyways, that was the biggest news story of the week. Mm-hmm. Moving on, it is discussion time. This is the portion of the show where we take questions from our listeners every week, every Friday. You can go on Facebook and submit a question there. Also, if you happen to be in Discord or any place like that, you can submit questions. Basically, anywhere we are, you can submit a question. And today, we got a chance to try out Astroneer, Jordan and myself. Mm-hmm. And let's go through and just give our first impressions of the game. This is a game that is in preview mode on the Xbox Live. It's a preview game. Jordan, let's start with you. Tell me what it is that you like about this game, first off.
Well, it's very, like, Minecraft-y. I mean... Yeah, I guess you could say it's very Minecrafty, like we said, Stardew Valley, or what was the other game we used?
No Man's Sky.
No Man's Sky. Yeah, it's actually
you take No Man's Sky and make it fun.
I like it. I had a lot of fun. I spent a lot of time in it. I'm working on traveling to another planet right now.
Yeah.
I built a rover. I built a truck. I built my base. The one thing I do think constructive criticism here. I think the storage units suck.
Okay.
Yeah, you didn't even build them. You didn't think it was worth it.
Yeah, it wasn't worth it. So what's funny is I don't know if it's a glitch. Well, here, let me explain the story. So I built so you land in your pod, right? And you get out and you can build your base, right? So what I did is I built three long and then I came... So I built basically six long, so there's three squares. Does that make sense?
Okay.
Because your base is a set of platforms, and each platform is connected by this long power wire.
Okay, kind of like Rust, kind of, or
no. So like,
I'm trying to visualize this.
Okay, so like, you have your main
pod. As a guy that hasn't played.
So you have your main pod, right?
Okay,
which is where you sit, sleep, save, all that stuff, right?
Okay,
And
it's a square.
When you build your base, it like pulls out this big electricity wire because it's got to connect the electricity and the oxygen to another platform. And from that platform, you build like a armory or
a crafting platform.
Yeah, a platform, right? So what I did is I built six platforms long, right?
Okay.
So I built three, and then I went up and built three back. So what it did is it made, because of those wires, it made three squares.
And okay. Jordan throws all his stuff
and
in
what
there.
I use with those three squares is that's what I use for my storage, because you can find and research how to make a storage unit, but it only holds eight things.
And
I have so many things, and I'm like, well, why am I going to waste a platform to put eight... You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I put it in my little box.
Jordan
there.
Basically has created the outer space junk drawer.
Yeah.
That's basically what he's created.
Yeah. So, I mean, I do take those storage units and put them on my truck because then it makes your truck a little bit bigger. But I wish it was more of like a chest, a box. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that would be my one gripe there. But I think the reason those are useful is because when a sandstorm came, a lot of my supplies blew away. And that was very disappointing.
So that's the purpose of the storage unit.
I don't know if it was a glitch, but it happened to be around a sandstorm.
If it was a glitch, you're just throwing stuff out willy-nilly. Yeah. So I don't expect it. I'm surprised it doesn't despawn.
No, because it stays there forever. So I was like, I'm just going to put
that
them
stuff
all.
Sucks to go.
Yeah,
get
I'm going
to
put it all in a box. So,
so you lost all your supplies
by.
And David lost your rover.
Not all of it. I mean, I had a couple things left, but I went outside and I was like, hey. Oh, hey, wait, man. A minute. It blew away all my stuff. And then, and yeah, yes, we were driving. David came into my game.
Yeah.
And he was driving my rover. I don't think
Jordan likes me in his game.
Well, I didn't. The truck took more supplies. The rover's not too hard to build. But
well, that wasn't my fault. Well, first I took the truck.
And all of a sudden,
famous words by Han Solo.
Yeah.
And all it's of not a sudden, my fault. David's driving in the rover that I built, and all of a sudden it just randomly disappears.
And I'm just running.
Yeah.
Where did the truck go?
It is a
preview. Did the wind
game.
Blow it away?
Yeah.
The wind. Yeah. It is a preview game, so I mean it has its glitches here. Single player, I didn't really have any problems.
Yeah.
Other than the wind thing, but I don't think that's a glitch. That was just unfortunate. Yeah. But and once David jumped into my game, it got really
multiplayer really is much quite, more glitchy.
Yeah,
than
much more
single player.
Rubber banding a lot. Yeah. It was really hard.
Funny story though, multiplayer in this game is a blast.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I jump into Jordan's game and I see this big vehicle and I just jump in it, and it's not his rover. His rover's the little one.
Yeah.
And so I jump in and I'm like, Jordan, this is awesome. Okay.
And I'm watching him like driving.
Yeah. And so
distance.
He sees me on the horizon and then he sees me and then I'm gone. And I drove into this huge ditch because you can't see it. You're on a planet and you can't see them all the time because everything's different colors.
Yeah.
And we couldn't get it out.
We had we spent 20 minutes trying to rig toys to get it out.
So in Astroneer, what you do is you're on a planet, obviously in outer space, and you're just trying to get resources to build stuff and build your place, and then you can go to another planet and do the same thing. But your tool is this machine that either sucks up dirt or spits it out. So you can build towers or you can build deep holes. So we couldn't get it out, and so we just drilled down hoping. And I fell into a cave eventually, and I was able to drive out to the cave entrance.
We dug further so it opened.
But sometimes when you dig down, it's like just an endless pit, mm-hmm. and you could fall and just die, and that would be everything gone.
I have seen
that was risky.
I have seen on YouTube people trying to get to the planet's core, which looks like a lot of fun.
The planet core.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, but no, it's fun. It's $20. It is an early access game, and I'm not going to say it's perfect because it does have its, especially in multiplayer. Yeah. I think multiplayer, single player, I think you can get away with. You know, it's not too bad. But multiplayer, we just had a bad connection, but it was pretty laggy and.
No, it was. My first impressions are it's a super fun game. If you like Minecraft, if you like Stardew Valley, if you like these types of games, in outer space, then this is the game for you. Tons of fun. It's a time sink. Just like anything else. Mm-hmm. What I like about this game is what I like about Stardew Valley and the mines, the exploring aspect. Mm-hmm. It's much more exploring. Let's see what's out there. And the planets, they're randomly generated and just really cool and beautiful artwork. It's a really pretty nice looking game. So let me ask you this, Jordan. It is in preview mode. Does this... improve your impression of preview mode, lower it, or is it about what you expect out of a preview game? Do we like the concept of preview mode as used
so
by Astroneer?
I think, and I know, so the other week I was talking about, I think we were all talking about how early access is getting a little out of control. I think it is getting out of control, but, and I'm not going to say with the exception of Xbox, but I think when you put an early access game on Xbox, I think Xbox requires you to adhere to a certain standard.
Sure.
So I think those games in preview program are all pretty decent. I haven't played all of them, so I can't say for sure. But from the games I have played...
What standard are you talking about? Because Ark had its issues.
Well, I mean, for example, when you submit... Well, I guess those are all just for... Like, for example, when a game releases, they have to submit to Xbox, and Xbox reviews the code to make sure there's no malicious... Or, you know, it won't break their system. So I guess that's not technically a standard. They're just protecting their end, so it can still suck. But... But I guess you're right. I mean, but I still feel like Ark. Well, with the exception of coming out with an expansion, I still feel like Ark has had some. Consistent
no, but see, that's
update,
the
you know
that's
I mean?
The problem I'm talking about.
Yeah, I guess you're
when
right.
When you come out with a preview game, you have no drive because people are
already paying for it,
so you have no drive to finish the game.
No,
and Ark comes out with a DLC. It's just I don't know.
Well, that's
why,
what's frustrating.
That's what I think's out of control. Yeah. Not necessarily the code. I mean. The UI in Ark is
so maybe I mean
terrible.
maybe I see I didn't even think of Ark, so maybe that and that was just my theory. Maybe they don't have to adhere to a certain standard, but like for example, Gigantic is in preview program. I think that game is pretty much there. It just needs to be polished up a bit.
Yeah, but
you know
isn't
what I
that
mean?
Is that made by Microsoft? Who's doing Gigantic?
I think Perfect World does Gigantic, but I know Microsoft. I don't know
are
what
they the paying
the
bills.
I don't think they're paying the bills. But
they're related.
They have a stake in it. I mean, they're okay. they're. I think they're pushing it.
Because Gigantic would be a game that I would say is on the preview program that is excellent.
Yeah.
That game is good.
The only thing I think that game needs is just a little bit of polish. I mean, other than that, maybe a few UI changes here and there, but I think that game is pretty
much there. Well, Gigantic for the preview program fits because in those types of games, it would be the same if Overwatch was in the preview program. Mm-hmm. Basically, what you're previewing is you're ultimately balancing the game, balancing the characters, making sure all your maps are optimized, making sure your servers are set up, increasing weight or decreasing wait time, stuff like that. So that's the ultimate way to use, the ultimate perfect way to use preview.
To answer your question, though, David, I think this game, it definitely has improved my standing of preview mode and early access because it's fun.
Okay.
You know, I still think there's, I mean, I don't think it's quite up to where Gigantic is.
Yeah.
But I think they still have a little bit to go, but it's fun and, you know, it's not broken, I guess, in any way, but severely broken. And I guess actually the day I got it, which was Tuesday, they had just come out with a patch that fixed a lot of bugs too. So I guess we got it right in time. But no, I like it. And the benefit to preview program is the fact that this game is $20 in the preview program. And when it comes out, it might be more expensive. Like, remember Elite Dangerous? We got it in the preview program. Was it cheaper than when it fully released?
Yeah, so we got it a little bit cheaper.
I mean, it's like
Elite Dangerous did preview program correctly as well.
Yeah, so I mean, I guess that's your advantage. I mean, you get the game a little bit cheaper and early, but you are susceptible to bugs and crashes.
But see, Elite Dangerous, you know, came out.
Yeah,
it's a fully released game.
Yeah, that's the concern.
Well, and that's where you're taking your risk, right? Like, 2 years ago now, we bought H1Z1.
I don't like risking my money.
Well, that's, yeah, no,
I
that's,
do.
That's,
I'm all about gambling, baby.
What is it?
Well, some cases, yes. In cases like this, I don't know if I feel comfortable.
Was it 2 years ago now that we bought H1Z1, a year and a half ago? I mean,
I think that's fully released, though. I really do think it's fully released.
I don't think so. Because on Steam, it still says early access.
I don't think so.
And if it's fully released, then they did something wrong.
They have issues, right?
So to wrap things up on Astroneer.
I like Astroneer.
Overall, do you recommend people going out and purchasing it?
Right now?
Yeah, right now. Preview program.
Maybe.
I would say yes.
That was a long pause.
Well, okay.
I had to say something.
Yeah, I know.
It's hard to recommend games that preview or early access games because you never know what's going to happen, right?
Yeah.
They may come out with this great patch next week that ends up breaking the game. You know what I mean? Yeah, just because they're trying to work things out and fix it. For $20. Four combo meals, right?
Yeah.
So four lunches. I guess at work. You know.
I would say 3.2.
3.2 lunches. You know.
Yeah. Depending.
I think it's. I think it's a good experience for $20. Single player mode. The multiplayer does have its issues. We had its issues in multiplayer. But just if you like games like Minecraft, Stardew Valley, and whatever the other game, No Man's Sky, you know, I think for $20 you'll really enjoy this game.
Yeah, I would agree with you. So overall, I think our first impression is
from
very
what
positive.
I've read, the developers seem very like, hey, we're here. We're going to keep updating it.
And that's key. Communication from developers in a preview program is also key. So since we're on talk of preview games and preview program, we all had a chance to play Jordan's highly recommended Gigantic game this week, which is in Microsoft Xbox Live's preview program. Mm-hmm. Gigantic, for those of you that don't know, is basically a first-person MOBA.
Third-person
MOBA, like a lot like Smite, with some tweaks and some differences. Let's get our first impressions on Gigantic. Jordan shared his last week. He really was excited about it. In fact, convinced us to jump in and play with him. McSpicy, first impressions on Gigantic.
I think the game is excellent. I really enjoyed playing that game.
Even when we got hammered.
Yeah. I think that game is, I mean, it's free.
Yeah,
it's free, so you can't hurt playing it, and maybe that's why I liked it too. But no, just
no risk.
It felt. You said there probably needs to be a little polish made. As I mean, I've been exposed to some games that need a lot of polish, and I don't think this is one of those games. I think the formula is good. I think the heroes are very fun to play with and play around with. I think there's heroes that suit my style. I feel as though this game is what Battleborn should have been, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Because Battleborn, I mean, it's a good game. I think it just had a lot of issues, A, when it released. B, it's a hard game to stream for, you know, I think there's just so much going on all the time. It's really confusing sometimes. I mean, even good players would have problems and a hard time seeing certain things because there's so much happening.
Sure, yeah.
I think if you were to clean that up and you were to, I don't know.
You would have gigantic.
It's a really good game. And I like it because it's just fun.
Sure.
It's just a really fun game, especially with friends. There's not minions.
What do you think of that?
So
in a MOBA game, you have minions that come down. There's also not lanes technically either. It's much more open world.
It's like a battlefield where you have to capture. It's conquest mode, you're saying.
More conquest mode
Capture the flag at certain locations. Not capture the flag. King of the Hill, I guess, and then hold it. Yeah, checkpoint, whatever. And you hold those, and then you can put minions down. And then those minions can defend those points. And then the other team, you try to take those points so they don't get... Yeah, you explained it last week. I think it works extremely well. I think one of the reasons I like Heroes of the Storm, if we're talking about MOBAs, is they simplified the MOBA, mold.
Genre.
Yeah, they simplified the genre in a way that appealed to me, because I was 3 years behind in League and in Dota. So far behind.
Well,
that
you've got to spend a few hundred
hours and hours to
get your feet under you in those games.
In those games, and Heroes of the Storm simplified that enough to where a new player can pick it up and play it and enjoy it. And it's built in a way where there is progression to become very experienced and very good. Mm-hmm. There is a place for good players and a place for new players, I think, in that game. And I think Gigantic does this very well, with the simplifying that MOBA mold, mm-hmm. and removing the minions, removing certain things, and just, I mean, it's still complicated. There's things that I'm still learning about it, you know, but I really...
Well, it's more like in Heroes, it's more about your skill with the character, because there's no gear type of thing. I mean, you still level up 1 through 10 as the game progresses on, but you don't have to, like, whereas in League and Dota, which are still good games, but you have to buy gear and you got to do a certain, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that can make it a little bit more complicated.
Well, and I think Gigantic simplified it to an even greater extent than Heroes.
Heroes did, because there's, I mean, you remove minions, like, how do you play a MOBA without
minions? And then you're not, like, I love their skill levels. It's basically just two choices every time. And it's not that, if I pick this, it leads to that, and that, it's not that at all. You don't have to look at the tree necessarily to see, like, what complements. It's basically either, like with the characters that I play, it'll be either an attack option or a defense option. Mm-hmm. Like, and that's it each time. And you can keep track of it in your head. You don't have to look at the big confusing build trees or anything like that. So,
and I like how I have that Overwatch feel as well, where the heroes are very unique. You know what I mean?
Sure.
Like, and you learn to like certain heroes, you learn to hate certain heroes that you're playing against, and I really enjoy that. I like, believe it or not, in some games I like getting mad at things. You know, just like that. What's the melee assassin chick in that game?
Oh yeah,
who Jono
plays as? Not Tito. He's the
super
owl.
Frustrating.
Yeah,
but
she's very burst.
It's just like in Overwatch, where you're introduced to a variable that's hard to figure out, and so you have to figure out how can I counter that character.
Yeah.
And it becomes this balancing kind of thing. And then you can get abilities. You can choose abilities that will be better against that character. So it becomes very strategic in that aspect.
Yeah.
Bottom line, I think Gigantic is going to be one of my playing in my cycle games.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If that makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I would agree with you. I really enjoyed this game. It really has the carrot on the stick. I want to unlock certain characters, blah, blah. And I don't feel like it's too unfair or too hard to get stuff to unlock characters, which is huge. I mean, in these types of games, that has to be well done or it'll just turn you off and shut you down. So we're all in agreement that this is a good game. Give me a criticism of this game that you have, or something that you'd like to see changed or improved about the game.
So for me, like when I say a little bit more, it's not bad.
Sure.
But when you level up in that menu, I,
yeah, I know what you're going
to
say.
If they could just clean it up a little bit, you know what I mean? And yeah. I don't know how to, other than say, it looks a little
clunky.
Not clunky. I mean, because I can do it fast, and I play the HK a lot, which sure. is the robot, so I know the hotkeys, which are on the D-pad, which is fine.
HK is essentially the Bastion character.
Yeah. So, and I know the hotkeys for what abilities I want, but when I hit the back button and I go into the level up menu, it doesn't look as clean as it could be. You know what I mean?
Well, it takes time. It needs to be easier.
Maybe
it needs to be easier explaining what it does.
Maybe so. You know how when
they could summarize.
Yeah,
it better.
You know how when you scroll over an ability and it pops up two white lines to the sides.
Yeah.
Maybe
left and
if
right.
they just stacked those on top of each
just
other,
just like Heroes.
You know what I mean? Yeah, and just stacked it, and then I can go okay, and then it could still be A or B to pick, but instead of parallel, they're
sure.
horizontal. You know
sure.
what I mean?
So you want to clean up some of the UI there.
Especially the death UI. Not like the when you're playing, but when you die, there's quite a lot on the screen, and it just looks a little cluttery to me.
Sure.
It's not bad,
sure.
but I just prefer it a little cleaner.
Yeah, Mr. McSpicy, how about yourself?
Two things. I'm going to just, on top of what he's saying, uh-huh. I want it more noticeable when I level up.
Sure. Yeah.
Like there are times
when it's just really small,
and it's just a number at the bottom that just says you have 1 point to spend.
Yeah,
where maybe have it flash at the top or something,
or just like a big pop or star or something.
It could really affect the battle if you hold those and don't level up.
Well,
like I've had times where I'm doing five in a row. I'm like, oh shoot.
Yeah, I should have.
Well,
done
especially
this.
When we first started playing, you almost go a whole game without leveling up.
Yeah. Heroes does this really well, where it pops up and it covers a part of your screen. It's not cluttered, but it's there until you press something.
Yeah, to get it out of the way.
So to get it out of the way, so it's very noticeable and. It's I think it's incredibly important to level up because, like you said, it's if you don't do it,
it affects the game. Yeah.
You're going to suck that much more. Yeah. So my only other criticism, and it's not necessarily the art style. I really like the it's called cell shading, right?
Yeah.
That art style.
Yeah, I like it.
There's a map that has there's not boundaries on the map.
Where you can run into the water and die like you did.
I died. I don't even know how many times I died. But it doesn't really look like water because it's cell shaded. It looks like I can just run.
Looks
right
like ice almost because it's kind of a frost.
Yeah, it's icy.
And there is no forgiveness. I'm full health.
It doesn't say
touch
turn
it with my
in
toe.
10 seconds.
Just barely put my toe in. Dead. and deaths are crucial in this game.
Yeah, they actually are.
You give the enemy points to. You know, attack your base. But
so to summarize, overall, we're very, very happy and excited for Gigantic. It will probably be our MOBA of choice. Is that safe to say?
Yeah.
Well, at least
well,
on
it,
the console.
It really is.
On the console, yeah.
It really is
do you think,
a battle arena.
Saying that,
it's
do you think it could
PvP.
Compete with Heroes?
Well, Heroes is I don't think League. I think it has. I have to see how it performs against League. Heroes is kind of in a unique place because it's not very mainstream.
Yeah,
Heroes of the Storm. But it's still very good.
Yeah.
You know, so I think League is to MOBAs what Call of Duty is to first person shooters.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, it's the king.
It's the king. Mm-hmm. And it's when you play a MOBA and you play League, you literally play no other game.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so we're talking about League. I don't think you can crack that nut. Essentially,
it's gonna be hard.
You know, yeah, I mean, so. Dota's in second place, I would think, and then
well,
Heroes
I think,
in third. So
I think the advantage Gigantic has is the fact that it is on the console.
Yeah,
you know, it's also on the PC, and your stuff. It's not cross play as of right now, but you can jump and keep your save data from Xbox to PC.
I do like that.
But I think when you put like Smite, they brought in a whole new audience when they brought Smite to the console.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think prefer this than Smite, and it's the simplification.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Smite was complicated for me.
If MOBAs intimidate you, if you've tried them out and say they're just not for me, I would give Gigantic a try for you. They simplify it. It is a little bit confusing, probably, I would say, your first 20 minutes.
First couple games, yeah.
I would say it's like snowboarding. Go four times, get bruises on your butt, but at the fifth game, you've got it down.
Yeah I would agree with that.
And
yeah.
it's free, so I mean, if you say you end up hating it, all of you have wasted is your time.
Absolutely.
So, you know,
anyways, great discussion. Our likes, our criticisms, things we'd improve in Gigantic. There you go, everybody. Blake Densley writes in, a.k.a. Blake the Barber.
Oh.
I met him this week.
You did, really?
Yes. Well, because
Forza.
When we played
on
Forza.
Yeah. Cool guy. Yeah. Cool guy. Yeah.
Yes, he writes in and says he wants us to talk about how to respond to negative gamers. I've had one message me just to tell me, quote, "You suck at Forza." He says, I'm not...
That's
so great.
Blake continues and says, I'm not saying I don't. He just says, I can't believe this guy took time out of his day to write this message and send it to me. So how do you deal with negative gamers when you get that message? Well, what do you do?
Something like that right there, you just ignore. I mean, there's no change in that person's mind.
That's so funny.
I mean, let's be honest. We've all had that. I've had someone message me in Destiny and tell me some pretty crude things.
It happens all the time.
And I'll be honest. Sometimes I reply because I got a good one-liner. You know? You shouldn't. Yeah, you shouldn't.
They're out of you.
Stuff like that you should just ignore. But I don't know.
I usually reply with two words.
No, it depends on my mood.
Because
I can... I mean, when I'm mad...
You got pissed at someone in Overwatch.
When I get mad, I get personal. It depends on my stress level from work. Usually I'll just, ignore it, but...
And it's not like Forza is a team game. I mean, I would imagine this took place in a multiplayer match, which if you're doing adventure mode, where it just throws you into race after race after race, it's not... Yeah. For someone to take time to write that.
That is funny.
You want to hear a funny example of how I trashed, like when I'm getting personal?
Sure.
I used to play a lot of indoor soccer. You played with me a lot, and you played a lot. Yeah. There was a kid that I knew his brother, and so I knew him through his brother, okay? I knew his family. And he was just a straight up douche. He was just like kicking the ankles, pushing me into the wall. It was indoor soccer. And stress level is high, so I'm not mad. I just go up to him and I go, I know your brother and your family, and you give a really bad impression, and I don't know how much I like your family anymore. Yeah. And I get personal, you know what I mean? I was so mad. And then his face was like, you know what I mean? I don't want to say what I say to those kids.
Did you have a guy that came up to you and asked you why you were making fun of him?
I did. I don't want to tell that story. But I was trying.
That was funny.
I wasn't making fun. I guess my person. I was just being happy and like, And 3 weeks of that, he was just so serious. He's like, please stop making fun of me. And I was like, oh.
I'm so sorry. I wasn't.
I know. I wasn't making fun. I was just having a good time. We're bros, man. I felt really bad after that one.
That's funny.
Yeah.
So ultimately, I think the way to handle douches, especially on Xbox Live, if they're in chat, mute them.
Mute them.
If they send you a message, just delete it. And I think you can report them. I would report them.
I report when they get really bad. I report
and
them.
Say something like sexual abuse. Really go after them. really make them make that star rating go down.
So
anyways, great question.
So mute, that's like, and the game has to have a quick mute button. Like Call of Duty is really great and the fact that you just press the blue button and it mutes, those people really fast. Grand Theft Auto is a way not to do it because it's so hard to get into the menus.
I don't think they want you to mute people. I think that's a part of the experience.
In a game like Grand Theft Auto, like sending messages like that, I think that's a part of the allure.
In a world gone wrong, that is... I mean, for instance, in the stock car racing, Jordan and I were playing it, and you had people who, through the entire race, they didn't want to finish the race, so they would sit and try and knock you off the platform.
But, I think just ignore it. And the most important part is don't let it make you reflect poorly on that game, because the developers aren't... That's not how the developers...
Well, I think you just ignore them and come over to the X1 Bros. That's what we're here for. There's lots of fun
people
to play with.
We'll cuddle in and give you hot cocoa.
Speaking of Forza Horizon, are we going to... Mr. McSpicy and I had discussed this. Are we going to try to get our X1 Bros. Club into... We tried it earlier in the summer. There was just not enough people playing it and not enough people in the club. Are we going to try this week?
Sub 100?
Get into the top 100?
Let's not do it this week. Let's plan for next week so we can get a week of people preparing.
Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So everybody, prepare. We think we have an easy way to do it. McSpicy has created a blueprint challenge that if we all do it, should be really easy to get us out of the top 100.
Yeah.
So prepare. Next week, we will announce it.
So Yeah. So, and you can practice it right now. I'm going to go ahead and tell you the blueprint. It's over by the Outback Horizon Camp.
Yeah, it's two. If you're looking at the map, it's the one closest to it. To the left.
Just west
of the airport.
It's just west. Go to that blueprint, and when you view the blueprint, you should see, if you're friends with me on Xbox, which I think most people that play it are, it'll say Mr. McSpicy, something like Ultimate XP or something like that. It's just my blueprint.
It's a 30-minute run.
And you just drive against traffic.
Drive against traffic, but don't complete the race. Before you get to the end, turn around and drive against traffic the other way, and then turn around and just keep doing it till you get to about 25 minutes. And then when you finish, you'll have a ton of XP. And
I get like 600,000 to 700,000 XP per run.
Okay.
And that's XP. That's not the star points.
Is that because of the car you have?
Yes.
Though?
So people might
get a little less. Or
no,
so, you know, or
in the blueprint, they'll be playing my car.
Okay, I didn't know that.
So it's because the car goes so fast, it has near misses almost all the time.
And it's a Horizon Edition car for skills.
Is it a skill car? Okay,
yeah.
I didn't know
so
that.
Every skill,
so your skill points are being boosted more.
Yes.
Okay.
So
that means you can unlock the tree, skill tree, a little bit faster too, huh?
Oh, I have like... I don't know, 500 stars now.
Mm. Have you unlocked all three skill
trees? Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Like nothing. You do this once, you can unlock everything.
So there you go. Great question, Blake. Thanks for writing in. Trobador writes in and says, after VR, what else can be innovated in the console gaming space? We've had motion controls, camera games, AR games, and now VR games. What can possibly be next? Any thoughts,
ideas? You guys ever read Ready Player One?
I never have. My wife has, though.
I've read it.
It's okay.
Yeah.
It's there's some parts that are definitely interesting.
Sure.
And there's other parts that are like, okay, that's cool.
It's like a post-apocalyptic. The author portrays this world, a video gamer's world, in a post-apocalyptic-esque world.
Yeah. Sure. It's a dystopian.
Yeah. Yeah. And he has like, this is what I'm going to just say bothers me a little bit. He paints this picture of, when he travels, he has to hire 6 armored people to take him, you know, just totally like a Mad Max thing from point A to point B. And then the next chapter, he's ordering pizza. I don't think that...
Does the pizza delivery guy have to have 6 bodyguards when he delivers the pizza?
Yeah. I don't know. He just orders pizza and has a good time. I don't think those worlds collide, you know? Yeah. You know what I mean?
It was a good enough book. You know, it's not my favorite book, but it was good. And if you like video games, I'm sure you'll find some fun stuff in there. But I think if you've read that book, that'll be like the next step. So it's still virtual reality, but it's more like in depth. Like
4D instead of 3D.
Like the Animus. You know what I mean? Yeah, like you lay down in the Animus and then you're in this world.
That's actually kind of
essentially what it is.
Yeah.
Except it's not his ancestors. You know what I mean?
I think it'll be more simple than that.
Do you know what I wish would happen? That in VR wouldn't happen. No, just
there
kidding.
Could be
no,
the.
I want like NVIDIA and AMD and all those people to put more money back into the hardware, because everybody's been pushing mobile, and I think that's been hurting high end PCs, high end gaming.
Sure.
And I mean, the market's telling them to do mobile, so I can't blame them for it, but. Remember the spike in hardware, you know, like there was just for months and months and months just power, 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 and now it's plateaued.
Yeah. Sure.
I feel like it's plateaued. I mean, we just had the GTX 1080 and the R9s and all that stuff just come out within the last year and stuff. But I want the boys that have the money and that have the power to make power.
Sure.
To make power. Yeah. And not I don't know. I don't care about saving 32 cents a year. On saving energy, you know? I'm American.
I think the future holds, we have like 3D graphics and stuff. Mm-hmm. I think you'll be playing in real life. So they'll have real actors that you play as, the world that you go around, they'll just take a picture. So for instance, let's say they do Los Angeles. It will just be like what they did with Forza, with the sky.
Yeah.
But the whole world will be that. Yeah. Just 3D rendered pictures of everything. So it's like you're
there.
It's real. When you're looking at it, it's actual... Real Grand Theft Auto, when people are walking down the street, it's actual actors doing that.
Doing that crazy stuff.
Wow.
I think that's
you don't need actors if you go to a place like Los Angeles.
You want the holodeck.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's endgame. The holodeck is endgame gaming.
And they mentioned it in chat, and I was thinking about this one, too. The smell-o-vision that South Park had for their game. Like, when you went to the toilet, you can smell it, you know?
Yes.
Something like that.
And the Nintendo Switch, that made me laugh, like the glass of water thing.
Yeah, or the udders when you milk a cow.
That was hilarious. Yeah, yeah.
In fact, I think Organic in chat mentioned that you can feel that it's squirting.
Yeah, that was hilarious. But I mean, those are, I think, like the glass of water thing I was actually really impressed with because it shows like the sensitivity and accuracy of those rumble packs, you know, yeah. Which I thought was pretty cool. But the udder thing, that was hilarious. Like, I don't know how, like when they're sitting in the board meeting, I want to hear that conversation.
The board, they have their board meetings. Like, and they're probably so serious, but I don't think I could keep a straight face.
Well, and I know that, so that 1-2 Switch game, I know that's not a like AAA title. I think that's a game just... Like it was like Kinect Adventures. It's just demoing what the technology can do. But yeah, if you have not seen that utter game.
Anyways, the future is exciting. Yeah. Great question, Troubadour. To be honest, I think our answer is we don't know. We don't know what the future holds.
The holodeck. That's what we want. It's what we want.
Hopefully
right?
better games and gaming machines that we can all enjoy.
Yeah. So more power.
There you go. There you go. Last but not least, Sean Ambrosi, a.k.a. Breakshoe, writes in and says... With Scorpio coming in fall, how important do you think early adopters are to a new console generation? This is a pertinent question because the Scorpio is coming, the new PlayStation is coming, mm-hmm. and now you just have the Nintendo Switch, which is coming. How important are new adopters?
Very.
Brand new adopters.
Extremely.
Okay.
Extremely important.
I would agree with you that. And this is the second part of his question that now I think we need to address because this is the meat of it. Throughout the years, it seems console makers never seem to appreciate core gamers who don't wait and buy at launch. Some type of reward for early buyers for limited time would be nice. Mm-hmm. What do you think? Do you think that game companies need to go out of their way to reward those hardcore gamers, the early adopters, the pre-order people, I've already pre-ordered every single game for it. I'm going to play it as soon as it comes out. Yeah. Take the day off work. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Should they be rewarded?
And in case by case, I think this already happens, and sometimes it annoys me, and sometimes it doesn't.
Okay.
Like, for example, when you bought your Xbox opening day,
sure,
you got the Xbox
day one controller.
Day one controller.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's enough. That's unique.
That's enough. Yeah, I like that.
That's,
in fact, I still have that controller, even though I don't have that console.
Yeah, didn't you spill Dr. Pepper on it or something?
My wife.
When you do have the day one achievement.
That's just a shame.
Yeah.
That's too bad.
You have the day one achievement.
I have the day one
achievement. And the day one achievement.
Yeah. You can never take that away from me.
That, I think, is okay. When it comes to, like, I don't know, GameSpot, GameStop, or these companies that are, if you buy it with us, then we'll give you stuff that enhances your gaming experience. I get bugged by that a little bit because...
Why?
I don't know. Well, some things, yes. Like if it's Master Chief's pink shoelaces, I don't care.
Sure, sure.
But if it's a weapon that has certain aspects that makes me want it, and I'm going to buy digital, but you only get it through a disc version, sure. That bugs me a lot.
Sure.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. No, I agree with you there. I think that's going away, though. I think everything is going digital.
But back to the point. I think they're kind of already doing that, at least with Microsoft.
Yeah.
With their day one editions.
I definitely think the early adopters, if you will, are definitely the meat shield.
Well, they're the Viking.
Yeah. Well, no, I mean, I don't mean it, but let's be honest. When Xbox now is far better than when we bought it on day one, right? Because of constant updates, feedback, and stuff like that. I'm sure next year at this time, the Nintendo Switch will be far better than it is when it launches in March.
Yeah.
Because
of
update. You know what I mean? So I think as an early adopter, you help mold, you know, the future with your opinions and stuff, right? Because, and I don't know, I think Microsoft does a good job of listening to their, I think all three of the companies do, Nintendo, Sony, and Microsoft do a pretty good job of listening to their core audience.
Yeah.
You know, via updates and stuff like that. But I know what you mean. Like, you know, you are the meat shield.
Yeah.
Because you're taking a risk. You're taking a $400 risk that it's going
to
be
good.
You're
the loyal
fan.
I think, though, if you're a business, if you are any of these console makers, this is kind of your loyal fans. You don't have to reward them. Like, their reward is getting to play your system.
Yeah.
I mean, they're that loyal. They will always be there.
That's very pro-business of you
so
to say.
So there's kind of not an incentive. There's kind of not an incentive for
Well, I mean,
no, and like you said, like, I mean, like... Sorry, go ahead.
There's other ways to do it, too. Like, when a new game comes out and I buy it on Xbox, for example, they have their rewards program or whatever it is. Sure. You get your points. Mm-hmm. And you can use those points for other things. I get those all the time, and I don't even mean to, but that's another way to...
Yeah.
Because they do those specials where if you buy it within these 2 weeks, we're going to give you Microsoft points.
Yeah, like with Halo, I bought Halo on day one, so I got an extra...
15,000 points right there.
Do I have a bunch of Microsoft points? I don't even know.
I think it's like 2,500, so they throw it into the Microsoft wallet. So you just go to rewards.com.
I think I have some.
Because if you ever, like, sometimes I'll randomly buy a game, I'm like, oh, I have 20 bucks. That's nice.
There you go. Yeah.
And so I think that's a way to reward people that are buying in a certain time period.
But I do like what you said, David. Like, that's... Because, like, for example, like we just pre-ordered the new Nintendo Switch, right?
Yeah.
I'm just excited to get it on day one and be a part of that day one experience. You know what I mean? Yeah. I'm not necessarily concerned about getting
any of the
rewards.
Perks.
Yeah. So I mean.
Okay. Yeah. Anyways, great question.
And with that,
There you go. Great question, Sean Ambrosi, a.k.a. Break Shoe. Thanks so much for writing in. And with that, let's move to our last and final segment of the show. Oh, this is the portion of the show where we talk about what we've been playing and what we've been up to. Let's start in the middle with Jordan, the man. Jordan, what have you been up to this week?
Well, a lot.
Okay.
Okay. No, I played Overwatch. I got my ranked matches out of the way. I played the new map. Overwatch, it's a fun game. I mean, it's definitely valid for getting the game of the year from all the awards people.
Sure.
You know, but
those folks over there.
Yeah, no. So, it's a fun game. I mean, like any competitive game or shooter multiplayer, there's sometimes where you get frustrated, and I'll get frustrated with Overwatch, but... I take David's advice where there's the one or two games where I get frustrated, and it's helped. I only get frustrated with Overwatch now.
That's my
competitive game. And that's how I like, I mean, I find I don't get frustrated in a bad way, but just like, oh, dang it, we could have won, you know, like.
Well, I mean, get frustrated in a bad way.
It doesn't make me hate the game anymore. Okay. Like, I always enjoy the game, right? I think it's a well-developed game. But I played that. I got my placement matches done. Someone left one of my placement matches, and that's mostly when I get really frustrated.
Sure.
Like, if we lose, we lose. I can take it, right? Like, sure. Hey, you outbeat us, right?
Yeah. Sure.
I understand. But when we're winning and then someone leaves and that's why they beat, that's what I think it's frustrating. Yeah. But I played Gigantic, which was fun. All four of us played on a team, and we dominated.
Yeah.
And then I played just with Mark the next day, and we got spanked pretty bad.
That game. So Jono and
John, I had to grab my ankles.
So yeah, Jono, like, man, and myself, we had that same experience. Yeah, that game is built for team play.
I think you do. I mean, I've won more with you guys than I have by myself, obviously. But that's definitely you're at a way disadvantage if you don't have communication with your team.
Yeah, well, and what you got to do is really just see where your whole team is at, and you've got to follow them. You really can't lone wolf it in Gigantic.
Yeah, it's a fun game, though. So I played that. I played Final Fantasy. I'm on the new Game Plus.
Oh, back into Final Fantasy.
Nice.
Yeah. How is Game Plus? How are you liking Game Plus?
Good. It's actually really easy right now.
Okay.
Because you're just at the beginning?
Yeah, and I'm maxed out on everything.
Okay.
So
is there going to be, like, in... I don't know, different gear as you play, just like in Dark Souls?
I don't think so.
Because you know how you got, like, the gear gets introduced in New Game Plus 1 and Plus 2, Plus 3.
I don't think so. I think they just put it in really quick just so players can keep playing.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Till the DLC and stuff comes out. They do have the Chocobo Fair at the end of the month, which I'm excited for. Got my ticket.
You gotta get your ticket to go to the Chocobo Fair.
Yeah. No, it would be cool, and I think they had... I haven't noticed. I think it would be cool if they added more equipment. Like you said, like, hey, we're going to add this in. It's a random drop. We're going to add more outfits in. Because I'll be honest, I love that game, but the outfit system is very underwhelming.
Yeah.
So that would be my suggestion to the developers, more outfits. I mean, it'd be cool if I can go to a shop, and this may sound funny, but if I can go to a store and, like, shop for clothes.
Well, you want your character to look sweet.
Yeah, you can make your character... I mean,
it's role-playing.
I like Prince Noctis, but it would be cool, like, if I can dress him how I wanted, which sounds really weird.
No, that doesn't sound weird.
I mean, like...
It's just like it's just armor, like, and Destiny. Yeah, everyone goes for the armor and Destiny.
You go for the armor and Destiny and stuff like that.
Look at what we wear in Grand Theft Auto.
Yeah, right.
You know what I mean?
But I just... That's a fun part, so I wish they would have more of that. And I think they've said they were going to add stuff and they're going to look into it, but it was a little underwhelming, so I wish they would have more of that. And I think that could be cool in future DLC. But I played that. And then I've been playing Earthlock.
Oh, yes. And you were excited when this game first came out. You really enjoyed it.
Yeah, yeah. I'm actually going to do the all the achievements on it. That's why I'm playing it. Yeah. Okay. That'll be the first one of the year.
Oh, boom.
But no, that game's really fun. If you like turn-based games, that's a really fun game.
I do like turn-based games.
If you like farming, then there's a place for you in that game because you farm your ammunition because you use seeds. It's very... it's very green, that game.
Good.
You know, you use the land as your ally.
Yeah.
But no, that's a fun game. I don't have any quarrels against that game yet. Cool.
All right. Anything else? Was that it?
Oh, I played Forza with you guys. I mean, not too long. Yeah. We tried your blueprint, which was fun. That car is nice.
Isn't it cool?
Yeah.
I think I might redo the blueprint, though, to get you my new paint job.
Oh, okay.
It's so sexy. It's like Knight Rider sexy. That's awesome.
That's funny. And then, I think I did play a lot of Final Fantasy Online this week.
Oh, that's right. Yep. And how is Final Fantasy Online?
That's good. For my birthday, I resubscribed to that game. Been playing it.
I saw John
Final
on that
Fantasy
as well.
14?
14 Online, yeah.
Yeah.
And everybody was asking me, how am I playing it on the Xbox again? Because it shows.
That game to come to the Xbox?
Yeah, that would be awesome. So how they do it is, like, it's on the PlayStation right now. It's on the PC right now. If I still have to buy the game for the PlayStation, but I just sign into my account,
okay,
and then all my stuff is there.
Okay.
So I wouldn't mind buying the game again on the Xbox and then just signing into my account.
Now,
I would love to see that game on the Xbox. I think that game is solid MMO.
Yeah, I know it's highly touted for of its aspects.
It's the number two MMO in subscribers right behind Warcraft.
Yeah. So. I mean, that's saying something.
Yeah.
So is it better than Black Desert Online?
I like it better than Black Desert Online. I know a lot of people like Black Desert Online, and Black Desert Online definitely has its place because of what you can do. I mean, you can literally play that game and build a trade empire and like not ever have to go to I mean, that game is very in-depth,
yeah,
which is cool, but I just like Final Fantasy Online style. Yeah. It's more of a Warcraft style.
I feel like Black Desert Online was a little bit disorganized. Like, I never knew what my missions were stuff like that. And Final Fantasy is a little more
Final Fantasy
focused.
Is definitely... Warcraft and Final Fantasy are very
similar. It's
beautiful,
too. It looks, you know, it looks gorgeous.
They're very... They have... If you like World of Warcraft, you'll like Final Fantasy and vice versa. You know?
Okay.
But...
Yeah, that'd be cool.
Yeah, I think it would... And they've talked about it here and there, but...
Well, one day.
Yeah, I hope. I think that would be a good
game. We can only
hope.
We can only hope.
And it is a game where they have, I don't think they have as many abilities as World of Warcraft. Well, they might have just as many because World of Warcraft has condensed things. But my brother-in-law plays it on the PlayStation. He plays with us from his PlayStation 4.
So it is cross-play.
To our PC, right? Sure. And he prefers the controller, given that's how he learned how to play the game. So he, you know, but he likes it. He says he doesn't feel at a disadvantage in any way the controller.
Yeah, that's good.
So
better,
and that's saying
than
something,
Elder Scrolls Online.
I like it better than Elder Scrolls Online, but it's a different style.
Sure. Absolutely. All right. Well, I'll go next, and then we'll finish with Mr. McSpicy on what we did this week.
I'll be quick.
I played Forza Horizon 3 a little bit this week. Got back into it with McSpicy, and then I was playing it this afternoon and last night as well. That game, every time I play it, I am just revalidated in my opinion that it was game of the year, my personal game of the year.
Yeah.
It is... one of the best racing games I've ever played. Like, it just does such a good job at so many different things. Mm-hmm. I can play any way that I want, and it's when I jump back in, I never feel like I have to keep playing and that I'm punished if I don't play, but I also and so as a result when I'm not playing I want to play. You know what I mean? It doesn't give me anxiety. Some games give me anxiety if I'm not playing them. Forza does not, and it's just an enjoyable experience all around. I love that game. Astroneer, I got to play. We talked about that. Gigantic. And I did jump back into Divinity Original Sin.
Yep.
Hey! That's another game.
Yes. This is where I have to stick with my resolution to start a game and finish it because I was, I think, 4 or 5 hours in, which is quite a lot in that game.
Yeah.
And I don't have any idea what's going on. So I quit, and I started a new game, which is good, actually, because it takes out a really big tutorial zone for me that I just skipped.
Yeah.
But that is such a good game.
It is.
Here's a question, because I actually started that game this week, too.
Yeah.
And I'm only like 25 minutes in.
Okay.
Do you want to co-op it up? Or do you prefer to go solo? Because you can play with two people in your
game.
The way it works, though, is he's coming into your world to take over one of your characters. So when he leaves, that character stays with you.
so I
it's
don't,
not his
I don't
character
progress
coming into
in
your
mind.
World. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
But it's still, so,
but it's still fun, you know, like co-op wise.
We should start another game with the three of us.
What if I just
game.
Joined your game and called that my game?
Well, I say what we do is we create one for the three of us that we play together. It's only two players.
Yeah, it's only two.
Never mind.
Yeah, that's a stupid idea.
Never mind. How are you liking that game, by the way? 25 minutes in.
I'm only 25 minutes in. So I only had like 25 minutes to play. And I'm playing and I'm like, oh, this seems complicated. Yeah. There's a lot of reading and I don't know what I'm doing. I'm going to go to bed.
Yeah, you. So you'll reach a point, and you probably did, where it asks you to follow people into a cave. That's the tutorial. You have to do
that. That's right where I'm at.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
That's right where I'm at.
Don't skip that. You have to. If you skip that, you will not.
Yeah,
know
go
what
into
you're
the
doing.
Cave. You actually learn a lot of valuable stuff.
Yeah, really okay. valuable stuff. It's pretty long, but it's valuable. So that's the part
that
I got to skip.
Experience and level up.
Yeah.
Going okay.
It, so. Yeah. Anyways, Divinity Original Sin, that's my genre, that's my cup of tea, and I really enjoy that game.
Yeah.
So, Mr. McSpicy, how about you? What did you play?
Played Divinity Original
Boom.
Sin, 25 minutes 25 in.
Yes.
Yeah. Learning. I had my first fights. It was great.
Very nice.
I won.
Yes. I like the art style of that game.
No, yeah, it's. I like how when you're walking behind rocks and stuff,
it just disappears. It fades. I like that.
Like the and it's like a cloud disappearing. Yeah. Super cool. So I'm excited to get into that. Although, I need to have time. That's a game. I feel like Witcher, where
you have to dedicate time.
You
yeah.
gotta go. Okay, I'm
Divinity
an
mode.
An hour.
Yes.
An hour is Divinity mode. So. I played some Prominence Poker.
Oh yeah.
Just to dab a little bit.
Devil.
Mm-hmm. I did play Gigantic with you guys and on my own a little bit. I like that game a lot. I think it's gonna be on my games of
in your repertoire.
Yeah. I think it's gonna. I'm just gonna call it. It's gonna be pinned.
Oh.
The games that I play
it's
are
got pinned. Notice.
Mm-hmm. Forza Horizon I played with you guys as well. And then Overwatch. I mentioned this at the beginning of the show. That I got into that pretty. That was my game of the week.
Oh, okay.
That's what I've been jumping in hard to again, and I like it. It's that game, like Jordan says, that is my it's my competitive game.
Sure.
So I get mad. I get frustrated sometimes. Sometimes I have to take a walk.
Yes.
But there's just something about that game that just fuels me. It fuels me.
Yeah.
I like it. It's a good game.
I can appreciate that.
Yeah.
Yes. What is your game that you... So Overwatch, is there any other game that you've allowed yourself to get competitive angry at?
Dark Souls.
We'll call it competitive mode.
Competitive mode.
Certain games we set aside for competitive mode. What
this
are yours?
This is going to sound stupid.
Okay.
But Hearthstone.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
That game, sometimes that game wants you to lose, yeah. regardless.
The RNG is not.
Yeah,
there.
Sometimes it's just, and that's what I got to tell myself so I don't like
the
blow
odds
a blood
are not
vessel.
In your favor.
Just you know that, and sometimes it really wants you to win. Like I sit there and laugh and feel bad for the other guy when you have the nuts like every draw. You know what I mean? And you're just like he throws something down, and the only the card you pull is the exact card that completely, you know.
Annihilates.
Yeah, I can't say what I'm going to say, but just tears them a new one. You know what I mean? It's just like, and it's just, and then that game, it's just, even today I was playing and I got so mad. I had to do like 20 push-ups to get that adrenaline out of my blood.
I can see.
Yeah.
Okay, I appreciate that.
Hearthstone,
so Overwatch
and
Hearthstone.
That's funny because it's a stupid card game.
Yeah, Overwatch and Hearthstone. That's okay though. Jordan, what are your competitive mode games? Games that you've allowed yourself to lose it?
Overwatch.
Okay.
Probably Halo 5.
Okay.
And then I think Gigantic might be one of those games.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So you're choosing to
Well,
because
I can see myself playing a lot of Gigantic.
Yeah,
of course.
Me too. Yeah.
And it's strictly PvP, you know, so it's, you know, I can see.
Mine is only one, and that is Madden. Yeah. The rest I really...
Hey, isn't the Madden Bowl going on today?
I saw it on
Twitch.
Yes. So I would like to write EA or talk to EA. I feel like they really could improve the way that Madden Bowl is done. And all you got to do is just watch how they do Dota, League of Legends, or how they did Hearthstone with Blizzard.
Yeah.
They do a really good job, and how they do Madden is just not...
I don't know if it's
rent
so they
out
get
the local bar.
It just doesn't
like
have,
the puppy bowl at the
it
Super
It doesn't
bowl?
Have yeah. the feel, and you could see that it wants to. And I don't know where they're failing there. I don't know if it's the colors, if it's the venue, if it's. I mean, I think it's all of the above. I just don't think it's the right. This is what they do that annoys me, is they have like your announcers, play-by-play guys, pretty good. It's just like watching a normal thing. Yeah, I mean, not my cup of tea all the time, but not bad.
Yeah.
Then in between, they have some DJ or or mic guy. No, a mic guy like a Ryan Seacrest type, but not
Ryan Seacrest. If you're going to get Ryan Seacrest, you got to
get
Ryan
Seacrest. He's the best at that.
Yeah. He's literally
come out on stage
built for being a host.
Okay, and you've got to realize to be
it's in his DNA, yeah. like his arms.
Well,
his
and you've
got
to realize to be good
about
at,
him.
To be good at these games, you have to have no life. I mean, to be at that level, and it's not that you have no life. That is your life,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
like
yeah.
it's just it's like professional athlete. Your yeah, whole you life gotta, is yeah. sports. Your whole life is this, and so they just come out and they're busting jokes, and it's just so awkward. And it's just like last year. It was classic. Oh, you won, you know, blah, blah. I'd just like to thank my mom for letting me live in her basement this year while I trade. It's just like, oh, my goodness, guys, come on. And so the Madden Bowl is just, it can improve on so many levels. It's not up to par with the other events.
Is there there's no sort of sponsors or is there any circuits with Madden?
Well, here's the thing. So there is kind of sponsors because they get two pro players to play and then you can win to play against the pro players. And there's different versions. But yeah, they need to expand it somehow, like have a pro season.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like Hearthstone has circuits.
Yeah.
And StarCraft has circuits. Yeah. League, Dota, like all
no,
these people.
No, see, and it's not to that level yet. And to be honest, I don't know if they have the player base to do it, the pro player base to do that. I mean, there's a handful of guys at the top level that you watch, but I don't know.
Tournaments.
I don't know. There's just something that as someone who loves Madden, it hurts to watch that. And I don't know what it is. There's a disconnect. There's definitely a disconnect there.
So I originally was kind of upset when this happened, but Blizzard, back in the when I was a huge StarCraft fan, I mean, I still am a StarCraft fan, but they basically absorbed all the rights to all tournaments. And a lot of tournaments that I really liked at the time
sure.
were killed off.
Sure.
But what that did is it made that so now that all the tournaments basically have to be sanctioned or I don't know
yeah, yeah.
how they do it, it basically made sponsorship a much more realistic deal. Made people they added a point system to if you win this tournament you get X Blizzard yeah. points.
It's kind of how marathons work. You have to have so many points to get to the big marathons.
Yeah, exactly. And so throughout the year, all these tournaments that is sanctioned by Blizzard, now you have a Blizzard World Championship, or basically the World Championship, and they do that. I think EA that they could look at Blizzard.
Yeah.
And see how they took a game that was scattered with all their tournaments and all whatever it is.
Yeah.
And make it a organized
yeah, they need to
sports.
Do they need to do something.
It's kind of what Microsoft did with Halo.
Okay.
Same kind of idea. They
except
sanctioned.
Blizzard was successful.
No, Halo's pretty
I know,
similar.
I know, I'm just kidding.
No, Microsoft basically said, okay, we have all the, or 343, like, you have to be in our sanctioned, our tournaments, you know, and you
yeah.
You basically work your way up to the top. They call it the Halo Championship Series, so it's like the exact same as the World Championship Series.
So
StarCraft,
EA,
yeah.
you know, give Blizzard a call,
yeah,
go golfing.
And I don't know what the I don't know what the disconnect is. Maybe it's just me. Maybe it is like a really good and everybody enjoys it. But I there's something that doesn't connect with me, anyways.
Are there any hot girls on there?
On that. No.
Yeah, StarCraft usually has a hot Asian chick.
They really do.
There you go.
I'm serious.
And behind sign Ryan Seacrest, that's your best bet.
Yeah. Option two. Yeah,
option two
is a hot Asian chick.
Option two, sex appeal. Yes. Anyways, thank you so much, everybody, for listening to us this week. Mr. McSpicy, why don't you tell us what you'll be up to and where people can reach you?
After the show, I'll be playing Prominence Poker Boom. With a lot of the guys.
Yeah. Yes.
So that's coming up, what, in like an hour and a half?
Yes.
Or so. And by the way, that's every second Friday.
Second Friday of every month.
Yes. Of every month. If you want to join, go to the XoneBros Club on Xbox, and it'll be posted the week before, and then you can just sign up.
Post-Podcast Poker.
Post-Podcast Poker. That's what the official name is officially.
P-P-P.
P-P-P. P. But I'll be playing that.
That's a wrestler, DDP.
DDP!
But we changed it. PvP.
Okay, that's cool, man.
Okay, sorry.
Do you want to keep going with that? Should I take it?
Finish.
I'll be playing, I think, Overwatch this week. I want to play Gigantic as well. So if anyone else is wanting to play that with me, feel free to shoot me a message if I'm on. Most likely we'll game if I'm able to. So you can. My gamer tag is Mr. McSpicy. And Twitter, I'm Mr. McSpicy as well. That's what I'm doing.
Jordan, how about you?
I'll probably be all over the place.
You know, wild man. Yeah,
he's a wild card.
Wild man.
I'll be playing Earthlock just because I'm doing the achievements for
Earthlock. Does that have multiplayer?
No. It's single player, yeah.
Be cool if it did.
Yeah, no, it would. So, I'm excited for the future of that series. I think it'll be really good. But, I'll be jumping around.
Where can people find you?
Gigantic Overwatch. Jordan the Man X will be everywhere. So,
all right, I am X1Bros everywhere. I think I want to play Gigantic this week. I really do.
Yep.
And like I said at the beginning of the show, I will probably be jumping into Mass Effect 3 to prepare myself for Mass Effect Andromeda coming in March. And I also probably should get fairly well into it before Halo Wars comes out because I'm going to be all about Halo Wars, baby. All about that game.
So that this is going to be your console RTS.
It is, yeah. It is. Halo War, if it's as good as Halo, well, I'll tell you what, the main game doesn't even have to be as good as the first Halo Wars. This Blitz mode, I think, is perfect for console.
Mm-hmm. That's cool. Well, you remember Ruse? Did you like Ruse?
Oh, Ruse was really good. I loved Ruse, yeah.
How would you compare Halo Wars to Ruse?
They're different games. Ruse kind of had a set build order, and it was more about your economy building. Halo Wars, the first one, is much more like Ashes of the Singularity.
Okay.
Where it's capture points.
Gotcha.
And then you go. So, and that's what I like. I like the focus, and that's why I think I'm going to like Blitz mode. I like the focus on your military and this military versus that military strategy. Go.
Yeah. Because you're auto like collecting resources. You don't have to worry about managing. You just build the building and collects it, and it doesn't.
Yeah. Halo Wars was much better than Ruse, though, I would
say.
You
think so?
A class above. They're kind of different games. Ruse was very good, though. Super fun, but just different. And in my opinion, better.
Gotcha. Okay.
There you go.
And Ashes of the Singularity. I suck at that game.
It's hard to get.
I told Jono I wanted to play with him tonight, so I might be jumping on there later this evening. I really like that game.
Yeah, if you want to have a sucky guy on your team,
come on over.
Well, that's another thing. You got to get AI like four or five matches in, and then you kind of start to.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It's like snowboarding.
Well, because it's different than. I mean, you're very good at StarCraft.
Yeah.
And it's different.
Yeah.
I mean, your mind is going a certain way right now, and your body just doesn't want to. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, that's basically what's happening.
That's too real, man. That's too real. You know?
Anyways, thank you so much, everybody, for listening this week. Thanks for joining us. For those of you that haven't, please go over and check out our website. Check out the blogs. Our creative team is awesome. Support us. Support them. Go check out Patreon. We want to grow to the point where, you know, we can hire our creative team.
That would be awesome.
Right now, we are 100% volunteer, everybody, including ourselves. But we want to change that and expand and take over the world with positive gaming.